two of one kind and one of another kind, the odds of picking the different sample are 1/3. If you have two and two, it also comes out to be 1/3. And the only reason for showing this chart is that if you have one of one kind and six of the other kind, the odds of picking out the different sample is 1/7. But where you have six of one kind and six of another kind, the odds of separating them equally is 1 in 462. So that there is a big advantage to increasing the number of samples as far as the odds are concerned. But the difficulty is psychological and physiological. If you're trying to make six comparisons with six comparisons, you have a lot of different comparisons to make. And you get very tired, both psychologically, you get confused psychologically, and you get very tired physiologically, so that you get fatigue or adaptation. So that we very rarely use these multi-sample type of things for that reason alone. But they have a very big statistical advantage, because you can see that the chances of getting that correct is only 1/462, so that you really only have to do the test once, and you have a highly significant result if they separate all six from the other six. Okay, now just a word or two about the use of triangular tests as first as a difference test, where the odds are 1/3, that's fine. Then, if you ask the next question, this is which is different, the first question. The second question, which is sweeter? And then we get into very big problems. Let's say that the correct order, we will have 32 and 32. And 74. Now, if it's first finding a difference, that the chances are 1/3 that they would pick. Equal, and this one is by itself, so you're comparing these two together with this one here. So the odds of getting that correct is 1/2. Now, which table do you use? Do you use the table for 1/2? Or since they've already made this decision, 1/3, do you multiply the probability of getting a difference times the probability of identifying the pair that's sweeter and use the odds of 1/6? Now, in the text, we do use odds of 1/6. But since the text was written, we've all been thinking about this a lot, and we now believe that this is a new test, and that therefore we should use the odds of 1/2, not 1/6. But the tables in the text are made for 1/6, so be very careful when you do that. If you agree with our present position that the odds should be 1/2, then use the paired test odds. Use the table for the paired test in the text. But if you agree with us what we thought 9 years ago when we wrote this book, then you use the 1/6 odds and use the table there. And you can see why it's difficult to know which to do. Did, in fact, this test precede this test? If it did, then the 1/6 odds are correct. But on the other hand, if you consider that when they tackled the second question, they were tackling a new problem, and therefore the odds of 1/2 prevailed. In any event, the question is academic and mute, because we now say, and it already says that in the text, that you should not use the triangular taste test to find difference, and then after that to find direction. That that's an incorrect use of the triangular test. You should use it only for difference. Only for difference. Not for finding the direction of the difference. There are two reasons for this. One, first reason for this is that it's confusing. They've already been playing around with these three samples, and they've made the comparison, the first one with the second one, the first one with the third one, the second one with the third one, the third one with the first one, and the third one with the second. and they're fairly confused as it is. Then if having found a difference, we'll assume they got it correct, they now have to find which is sweet, and so they have to do the first one, the first two against the second one against the first one, and they find that they do not find as small a differences using the triangular taste test this way as if you had used a paired test all by itself to start with and simply said which is the sweeter. But the worst thing of it all is, what do you do, and this is the reason we don't recommend it, what do you do with the person who didn't find the difference? But he's a part of the population, he's a part of your universe, and you're just going to throw him out and only use the most sensitive people, the ones that found the difference, to answer this question here? Or what are you going to do with the person that got, said that the odd sample was this one here, when in fact it was not the odd sample? So the problem of what to do with the incorrects for difference is very difficult to know. And most statisticians now agree that you must not throw out data. If somebody does a test, they're a part of the test. You can't just wish them away. And that's exactly what you're doing if you throw all these people out. You can't use them because they've already demonstrated they can't find a difference. So how can they find out which one is sweeter if they can't find a difference? So you're in a dilemma, and that's why we say do not use the triangular taste test except to find a difference and forget about it. That's the end of it. That's a little bit different than what the text says. It's different than what Hilgardia says. It's about what ASTM, American Society of Testing Materials, say now. Use the test for just one thing, and that is best done for a difference. Now, a little bit about the multi-sample test, besides what I just said a minute ago, that they can be symmetrical or they can be unsymmetrical. Here is an unsymmetrical one right here, 1 and 7. Here is a symmetrical one, 3 and 3, or 4 and 4, and so forth. We don't know of any reason why one or the other of these is any better than the other one, except that the more tests, of course, you get higher probabilities. The analysis is based upon the binomial distribution. That's what these are. These are just expansions of the binomial. Well, you can use chi-square to do this. The chi-square distribution is quite as easy to do. What do you do with the, in multi, let's say that the correct order for the correct separation for four samples, a 4x4 test, is using the same numbers. This is a 4x4 thing of two samples, sample 32 and 74, and you've identified them, 32, 74, 74, 32. That's the correct way. This is correct. Now, suppose that somebody gets some 32, 74. So they've made only one error, and that's the error right here. They've switched this pair. Now, what do you do with that kind of data? Because this shows they weren't very sure of themselves. On the other hand, 6 of the 8 samples are correctly identified. This is what we call the use of partially correct answers in the multi-sample testing. And we are rather reluctant to use these partially correct answer data. We think it would be better to go back and run the test as a paired test, rather than using this incorrect information. The statistics to be applied are also questionable. You remember last time we discussed whether to split the incorrect ones each way or throw them out, and can't throw them out, and splitting them sometimes doesn't seem to be the fair thing. So if you get data like this where they do not correctly identify them, even though there is some evidence that this person can differentiate 37 from 74, it would be better to do the paired test without the psychological confusion of the multi-sample test as four different pairs. Only you'd have to do more than four different pairs. Well, I think that's all I'll say on that, and we'll now go on to the two things that are on your outlines today. I'm going to leave the material on page 349 and 350 until next time. Not till next time, till next Thursday, when I will talk about the whole elusive thing of what we mean by quality in foods. Now, in ranking, there are two kinds of things that we can do in ranking tests. One, we can rank things in order of intensity. You give a person a sample and you say rank it in order of sweetness, or rank these samples in order of color, and so forth. That is comparatively unequivocal, pretty straightforward, and is one of the things that the ranking tests do quite well. But you may also tell them to rank them in order of flavor. And that's not quite as clear, because everybody has a different idea in their mind as to what flavor is. To some people, flavor will be more odor than taste. To some people, it will be more taste than odor. To some people, it will be a juxtaposition of flavor, of a taste and odor, as revealed in the mouth, which is the sort of thing that we practice around here, or try to. But you can get some fairly good results in asking people to put things in order of flavor. But even so, there's some question marks about that. Then you ask them to rank them in order of quality. And that's a subject I'm going to talk about next Thursday. That's very much more difficult. First of all, it's hard to define what quality is. Quality is, you can write this one down, quality is much easier to recognize than it is to define. Quality is much easier to recognize than it is to define. Second, it's very hard to measure something you can't define. Very difficult to measure something you can't define. And worst of all, it's very hard to interpret data where you don't know how to measure it and you don't know how to define it. So, in addition to that, the quality standards vary so immensely between people. They also vary not only with people, but with the intended use of the product. You give a person, we'll say, tomato ketchup to run quality standards. Some people conceive of tomato ketchup as half the meal. So that's their definition of quality. Other people hate ketchup and won't use it at all. Other people use it as a condiment or as an addition to certain things, but not to other things. So the intended use of the product and the audience define quality in many cases. And the conditions of testing are very important in quality things. We are much more distracted when we have to make quality judgments than we are when we have to make difference judgments or intensity judgment. In this case, the mind can concentrate on one single job. When you ask them what quality is, they start thinking, well, now, what is quality and how do I define quality? And one person does it one way and another way. So the conditions of testing and the frame of reference of the judge. Different people have very narrow frame of reference. If it isn't prime beef, it's no good. Other people have a very much wider frame of reference and can do small differences very easily. All right, let's talk about now ranking alone, which is sometimes used for both of these things, for intensity, for flavor, all three of them, for flavor and for quality. The general principle of ranking was discovered in the 18th century, and it has been used in a great many psychological tests of various kinds. The usual things is to arrange two or more samples in some ascending order or descending order. In most cases, we do it in ascending order from left to right, but in some cases, they do it in a descending order. In threshold tests, when a ranking is used as a threshold test, it may be used in a decreasing order because you're not interested in the very bottom sample on one side, the lowest sample. You're only interested in finding out if they can tell the first samples. But it can be used either way. We prefer here, and most of our tests here are given in ascending order. In ascending order. People generally react to that better. It's limited in some cases to only selecting the first one or two samples. If you're in new product development, for example, and you have a standard, and you have five or six new apple pies, you may be asked to rank them. But in reality, the only thing they're interested in is the first two samples. They're not going to develop six new apple pies for the market. They're only going to develop one, or maximum two. And so you don't examine the samples at the lower end, the inferior end, as well as you do the samples at the top end. So ranking can be partial ranking in that case, where you simply use an elimination test for the bottom and forget about those samples and concentrate just on the top ones. You don't have to rank them all. A third variation was to screen out inferior from superior samples. And that's essentially what I just said before. You screen out the two lowest ones and then rank the two top ones as against the standard. Or you may be running tests on new genetic strains of some fruit or vegetable, and you're only interested in ranking the top parts of it. How many things can you rank? Well, that's a very difficult question because every product is different. We are rather critical in discussion of the number of tests for milk products. There was somebody in milk products that Guthrie, I believe, who reasoned that you could do almost hundreds of milk samples, but he was working from Trout and Sharp's old paper on detection of salt and sugar and lactic acid in milk thresholds. Sharp was at one time the director of the Agricultural Experiment Station at the university, but earlier than that he was a milkman at Cornell, and his graduate student Dr. Trout made these, and his panels used milk samples for 2 and 3 hours at a time and literally did hundreds of samples for thresholds of salt and so forth. So Guthrie saw that data and said, well, if they did that, then they can judge milk quality samples for a large number of times. But Ms. Pangborn and I don't think that's true. Just because they have the ability to detect acidity or saltiness in milk doesn't mean they have the ability to detect quality in milk or to rank samples. It's a different kind of job picking out the saltiness than it is to rank things in some sort of order of quality. So in general, we think that 20 is too much, and that we'd be better off if most of our rankings were 5 or 6 samples. It's the job is very fatiguing when you get above 20. Even if it could be demonstrated that they could do a large number of samples, it would have to demonstrate with every person. And that would in itself, the testing would become rather laborious if we had to do that. It is possible to use incomplete block designs and rank them. That is, you'd rank 4, but there would only be certain ones in it, then you'd rank another 4, and there would be certain numbers in it, and another 4, and so forth, so you got all of the samples ranked and all compared in the block design, or the incomplete block design. We've done that a little bit here. We've played with that. And the big disadvantage of it, what would be the big disadvantage of it? You get a huge amount of treatment times block interaction. So in your analysis of variance, the error due to this is very large. And this makes the testing more laborious, of course, in order to get around this error. In general, we favor the use of an anchor sample, or a standard sample, if you want to put it that way, in ranking tests. First of all, it
it's a good way of testing the judge. And second, it gives a sort of internal standard to the thing, even though they don't know, it's an unknown one, but they say that, well, that flavor, that's the kind of flavor, and I'll rank it in a certain way with respect to the others. You can also use dilution as a ranking procedure. And we're going to talk about dilution next Tuesday, where the amount of material that's required to dilute out a off odor is used as a measure of how much of that off odor is present. Now, you can do a whole series of dilutions that way. That is, suppose you're looking for off flavor in cottage cheese, and you're putting into the cottage cheese some extra milk to dilute out the off flavor. Well, the amount of milk that you add is a measure of the amount of off flavor, the amount of milk that you add to dilute out the flavor, so you can't recognize it anymore. And if one sample uses less milk and the other uses more milk, that's a measure, or that's a ranking procedure. There are quite a number of other things that can be made into ranking procedures by this sort of thing. Now, first of all, you have to use trained panels. There's no point in doing ranking without paying trained panels. And I can't emphasize that enough. Ranking without trained panels is likely to be quite meaningless, not likely to have much meaning. And the judges must know what they are ranking. They must know that they are ranking for color, or they're ranking for texture, or they're ranking for flavor intensity, or they're ranking for general quality. And they must have a clear, each of them must have a clear concept of these. Because of this problem of what they're ranking on in the judging of canned fruits in California now, they have panels to rank on each ingredient or each constituent. The blackness of olives, there will be one, a color panel on olives, canned olives. So one panel will rate the olives, rank the samples of olives on the basis of what the color is. Another panel will rank them on the basis of texture, whether they're soft or hard and crisp and so forth. And still another panel may rank them on general quality, or they may not even have a general quality panel. This is very useful for the canning companies of California. They have these cutting bees every year, and the canneries know which their sample is, but they don't know who the other samples are. And so they go through and they see that the panel that's been judging their olives says that your olives are too black or not black enough, or your olives are pulpy and pitty and have broken pits, and your olives are lovely and firm and so forth, or the general quality is thus and so. These are ranking procedures. Everybody understands ranking procedures very easily. Now, if you ask a single panel to rank the overall quality, that sometimes gets very sticky for another reason. The general quality varies according to the color and the texture and the taste and the odor. And so in a panel that's judging or trying to rank in terms of general quality, all of these are varying at the same time. And they're varying very unequally. In one case, the color may be up, in another case, the color may be down. At the same time, the texture may be going in another direction. And the taste may be going in still another direction, and the odor is still another direction. So it's very difficult for people where they have multiple factors to judge, to isolate the overall quality when each of these things are varying at the same time, and they can see those vary. And so the judges assign different values to them. One of them says, well, even though he knows that he's supposed to be judging on quality, he said, but if the color is that much, it's no longer commercial, and so it has to go down at the bottom of the ranks. Whereas another judge says, well, the public is not that critical of color, it's black, and they're going to put it in a martini anyway, so who cares? And so he doesn't judge it that critically. So this means that you have to give a lot of training to the judges, and even with the trained judge, It's very difficult where many factors are varying at the same time and having different effects on the quality for the judge to isolate the quality factor by itself. And they usually do vary. Not just one factor varies with quality, but they're all varying with quality. That's the normal thing in food. Well, ranking is very rapid. It allows us to use multiple samples. You can use a large number of samples, 5, 6, 10. It lends itself to the use of a fixed scale. That is, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And you can have reference samples in it, which makes it, tends to anchor it. It really sets its own standard. The ranks are relative values, so that you're not judging against some theoretical thing, but you're judging in terms of this particular ranking. And that's one of its weaknesses. The rankings cannot be compared. One series of rankings may be very high, another series of rankings may be very low in quality, but they are ranked 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So you cannot compare one set of rankings with another set of rankings unless the materials are the same and the panel is the same. Now, we sometimes use ranking for selecting judges by giving them the same things to rank 3 or 4 times and see how well they repeat themselves. That you can do. That's perfectly all right. The use of rankings to select judges where they continue to rank the same things over again. Or two different panels ranking things. Two different panels ranking things. The same things. You can compare those if the conditions are the same and so forth and the task is the same. Another advantage of ranking is that prevents the judges who don't like the product from scoring all the samples zero. It forces him to distinguish between samples. Even though he might not like the samples, and if you gave him scoring to score the things, he might put them all at a very low score. But by making him rank them, you prevent that giving of low scores. It also forces a relative decision. In scoring, it's very easy to give things the same score. Give it 13, 13, 13, over and over again. But when you tell them to rank them, they can't give them the same. Or can they? Question of ties in ranking is another one of these problems in statistics that is not quite clear. If the ranks are to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you permit ties, then in calculating the ranks, we'll say that they rank them 1, and that 2 and 3 were the same, and then 4 and 5. 2 equals 3. Then these samples are then scored, this divided by 2, this plus this divided by 2. So each one of them would be ranked 2.5. So that the rank total remains the same. We sometimes permit ties. I don't know of any great objection to permitting ties, but it does take away some of the ability to differentiate these samples if you permit ties. And many people make a forced choice method out of the ranking procedures and do not permit ties. If you permit ties, you're going to get less differences between the samples than if you don't permit ties. Well, there are two big bad disadvantages of ranking procedures. You never know how much difference there is between ranks, particularly if it's a forced choice thing where you have no choice. You must make the ranks 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You may not, in fact, be able to tell the difference between 2 and 3, as in this case here, but you're forced to do so by the nature of the test that's being given. Even so, if you know that 4 is different from 5, is 4 a good sample and 5 a bad sample, or are 4 and 5 the bottom half of two bad samples? How far different is 4 from 5, and what is the relative quality of the thing ranked first and the thing last fifth? These may all be 5 first-class samples, or they may be all 5 dogs, and not worth anything at all. And the ranking does not give you any information on this. Ranking gives you no information on this. You can describe it, you can say that this is a very good sample and this is a very bad sample and we've ranked them in order, But just from the ranks themselves, you can't tell very much about it. Ranking has a very high sensitivity if the difference in ranks are rather large. If you've got fairly good differences between them, ranking is very sensitive method. Well, that's true of any procedure. If the differences are large, it's going to be more sensitive. Let me give you some examples now, just three examples of several are given in the book. Apple juice was ranked for acidity versus scores, and the ranking was just as good as the scoring, a little bit better, as a matter of fact. Another case, the mealiness of potatoes. The potatoes were described descriptively on a scale, very mealy up to pulpy or whatever they have for mealiness of potatoes, as against ranking them in order of mealiness. The ranking test was better than the descriptive test. People could put them in order better by straight ranking than they could by matching them with some descriptive terms. They got better results. Now, in a strawberry test where they were comparing differences, the best test was a paired test with 8 replications. Comparing one strawberry against another strawberry was directly was the best method. But ranking was twice as fast than the paired procedure if you were ranking 3 samples. Ranking was 3 times as fast if you were ranking 4 samples of strawberries, and ranking was 4 times as fast if you were ranking 5 samples of strawberries. And ranking was equally good as descriptive terms with respect to strawberries. And one other test now, with the citrus drinks, ranking was better than hedonic scoring. We'll be talking about hedonic scoring next time. Procedure for, in this case, results in scores, and the ranking turned out to be better with citrus drink than did hedonic scoring. Now, there's a little danger in comparing methods, which I think you all ought to realize. You're going to start a test to find out if ranking is better than paired testing for differentiating 3 samples or 4 samples. And you got the real first problem that suppose they start with ranking. They don't know anything about, we'll say you're ranking cherries. They don't know anything about cherries, and so forth. And a big problem in storage of cherries, too. That wasn't a very good example. Let me start with something else. You're going to rank rice. That rice doesn't change very fast. And so you get some results by ranking. Then you try the paired testing next. Well, the ranking has acted as a training period for the panel that's training for rice. So they're naturally going to get better results with the paired testing because they've gone through a training period with the ranking procedure. So the thing we say on this is that the panel must be equally trained in all the methods, and then the methods must be used alternatively or in some random order in order to prevent this training effect. Also, in some cases, there is what we call drifting. The scores tend to drift down or the scores tend to drift up. Now, in ranking, that's not true because you're ranking the same things over and over again, and so you will not, and you can only rank them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But the other test may turn out to look poor. We'll say the paired test or the scoring may turn out to look poor because the panel has tended to change its identification of the quality of rice, if we're judging rice quality. And so it looks like not very good results are being gotten by that. But by changing the scoring procedure, so as I'll be illustrating in just a moment, by changing the scoring procedure so there are standard samples, so that the panel is made aware of the danger of drifting and so forth, it's quite likely that scoring would turn out to be much better and wouldn't show this drifting effect. So be a little careful when you look at results comparing one method against the other to be sure that just in the way they did the test did not introduce an error. in it. And you'll be quite frequently asked, why don't you use ranking? Because it's very rapid. And you ought to be able to answer this question by comparing it with some other method. But you've got to train the panel in both methods simultaneously, and then you've got to use both methods alternatively or in a random order so that the training effect doesn't work. Now, how should we analyze the results for this? Well, there are various ways, and there are some statistical ways that I won't go into here. Let's say that this is the number of the sample. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We got 5 samples that we're ranking. And then put the, calculate the number of judges giving it first place, rank 1. These are the number of samples, 5 samples. Number 1 sample may have been ranked by only one judge first. Number 2 may have not been ranked by any. Number 3 may not be ranked. And number 4 may not be ranked. And we'll say that we've got 10 judges. And 9 judges may have ranked number 5 in first place. That immediately gives you a very good sized clue that number 5 is the best sample. Now, the results will not always be that clear. But that's one way of looking at this data. The other way of looking at the data, and now I'll make the test a little bit shorter. So we just have 3 samples, and number of times it was placed first, second, third, number of times placed first, second, and third. So this one was placed first 3 times. Let's see how many judges we're going to have. We'll have 5 judges. 5 judges, and this was placed first 4 times, and nobody placed this one first, and one judge placed this one first. Was placed to second, this was placed 1 second, and this was 1 second, and this was 4 seconds, and this was nothing. 5 judges, and it can't be 4, can it? This has to be 3, excuse me. You're right. And this is 0, 4. That isn't going to work out right either. It doesn't matter. It has to be 5 in each direction. 1, that's right. All right, now the rank scores on this. For the first one would be 5. For the second one would be 5. Oh, that's not what I want to talk about. What am I doing wrong here? Third sample. Oh, the rank score, I'll tell you how to do that. The rank score, this is 4 times 1, which is 4. And the rank score, this is 1 times 1, which is 1. The rank score, this is 1 times 2, which is 2. And the rank square, this is 1 times 2, which is 2. And the rank square, this is 3 times 2, which is 6. And this one here is 0 times 3, which is 0. And 4 times 3, which is 12. And 1 times 3, which is 3. Now, the rank scores on the first sample is 5. Well, 6, excuse me. 6. The rank score on the second one is 2 plus 12, which equals 14. And the rank score on the last one is 1 plus 6 is 7 plus 3 is 10. Now, by inspection, you've already decided that that's the correct order for the samples, that the middle sample is the worst sample, and the bottom sample is the next best, and the best sample is the one up here. Now, these are the rank sums for these 3 samples, and it shows the same thing, 6, 10, and 14, what we call averaging the ranks or averaging the or getting the rank sums. Now, this data is best analyzed by looking in Table I. In Table I, you'll have Table I, but you can put it on the board what it's like. There is what we've been looking all over Doug and I for. Lecture did me some good with it, but you were not. I found the lost data that we've been looking all over the laboratory for. This is what we call the Kramer table. It's very easy to use. Everybody's seen this, the use of the olivetic underwood. It doesn't take very long to do coefficients of correlations on it, so I recommend that you do it. This is a 3x3 test, and in table I, you go into a 3x3 test, and it shows that if the ranks are between 4 and 8, there is a significant, the rank totals are between 4 and 8, there is a significant difference. Well, this one is between 4 and 8, so these two are not significantly different, but this one is significantly different. The rank totals are have to be outside of, they have to be below 4 or they have to be above 8 before they're different. And there is one that is outside of them, two of them that's outside of them.
See, four.
Pardon?
Well, you can't get a 4, you have to have, you can only get a 5, I think you have the wrong column.
No.
The table?
3, 3.
Well, you can't get a 4, you can't get below a 4. Right.
Sure, you can get below 4.
You can only get a 5.
You can only get a 5. Five ones.
That's right, if you got 5 ones. Well, I don't know how he got that, but that's what he says. Even so. Let me make it a 4x4 table with him. That'll take too much time to do that. At any rate, if it's not, if it's below, it's outside of these limits, it's significantly different. So, 3 treatments and 3 judges is what's given here, 48.
3x5.
Oh, I've got 3x5. Excuse me, I'm sorry. 3x5, yes, you're right. It's 4 to 14. 4 to 14. 3x5 is 4 to 14. And that means that there is no significant difference between any of these. They are all within that range. And therefore, they do not differ significantly from each other. It would look, you know, just looking at it, that you'd think there might be some difference, but there isn't any difference. You'll find in this table that there are two lines for the 3x5. This is 3, and this is 5 here that we're looking at. There's a top line and a bottom line. The bottom line is, in this case, 5x13. And that would mean that this was truly the worst sample. We've been using the upper data, the more rigid data, rather than the lower data in this. There's a reason for that I won't go into statistically here. So use the upper data when you have ranking data for a quick estimation of the significance between the two, or that's whether there is any difference in the rank. Now, there is other ways of doing this. You can convert the ranks to scores. You have the average score on this one here would be 4 times 1 and 1 times 2. The average rank in this one is somewhere above 1. And in what's called the Fisher-Yates table, you can convert ranks to scores. And then you can use them by the usual binomial distribution. It turns out that in ranking, the distribution is not normal. So you cannot use ranks directly with binomial distributions. Ranks will not work. You have to convert the ranks by a table over to some binomial distribution. And the Fisher-Yates tables are the best ones to do that. The departure from the normal is sufficiently great that it will make the statistics come out wrong. And then you can analyze them. There are other kinds of things that, that you can do for this sort of thing. All right, so much then for ranking. Let's talk about scoring a little bit more rapidly. It is the most frequently used test that we have at the present time. It's almost every laboratory has some sort of scoring system for different products and so forth. On the surface, it's apparently very simple. You give a score to the product, and then you treat the scores as if they were binomial distributed, normally distributed, and go ahead and analyze the data. The assumption is that the scores are proportional to the quality in some way. And that's a very big assumption and in some cases is not justified. It's been used for a long time, for more than 100 years in the dairy industry now, or about 100 years in the American dairy industry. And scores have been used in psychological testing for a long time. How do you get a good scorecard? Let's say you're going to make a scorecard for orange juice. Well, what's the first thing you do when you're looking at orange juice? It's got a color factor. It may have also a clarity factor. It smells like orange juice, and it tastes like orange juice. And the two tastes that you're going to get in orange juice is sugar and acid. And there's also a bitter taste, three different tastes to get orange juice. So we'll say you're going to make a 20-point scorecard. So now, how do you weight the different values for orange juice? You want a 20-point scorecard. And how do you determine that this is going to be worth 5%, namely 1, or 10%, 2, or 15%, 3, and so forth? Let's say that we decide on 8. So here is a 20-point scorecard of which 10% is color, 10% is clarity, and 40% each are odor and taste. Well, how do we know that that's right? And how can we be sure that it is right? Well, first of all, a large amount of experience is necessary on this. You literally have to run hundreds of tests to see if, in fact, this distribution fairly rates the quality of orange juices. If it doesn't, if the scorecard doesn't work, then it's not properly weighted. So experience is the only judge we have in making a scorecard to see if it's going to work or not. Second, they have to be in some sort of logical order. And this seems to be the logical order. We look at things first, we smell them, and then we taste them. We don't know that this has a very big effect, but we do know that if you change the order, the judges will be confused. And they will tend to use their normal order, whatever their normal order is. The scale should be great enough so that it will take into account the entire range. Is 20 big enough range for orange juice quality? Or would it be better to use only 10 points as the range? Or would it be better to use 100 points as the range? Well, it's now been decided that the range in scores will be somewhere between 10 and 30 as a maximum. Somewhere between 10 and 30. If you make the range any bigger than this, you get a lot of fuzzy answers. That is, when you try and duplicate your results, on a 100-point scale, there will be a plus and minus 3 error all the time. So by reducing this down, you reduce the error of each determination. It has more meaning. You simply cannot distinguish 100 different qualities of orange juice. There isn't that many different kinds of orange juice quality. Unless you spent your whole lifetime doing nothing but tasting orange juice, you couldn't identify that many different kinds of orange juice. About 20 is about the maximum that most of us can do. Maybe occasionally you can do more. The judges must agree on how the scorecard is being used. They must use all of the scale. There's no point in having ends of the scale not being used. They must judge each factor correctly. They must have clearly in mind what the ideal color is and so forth for orange juice. That's why you have to have trained judges. They must have some sort of vocabulary for describing clarity and so forth. And you must try and train them so that the variability between the judges is reduced as much as possible so that you don't get very variable results between judges. We estimate this itself sometimes takes quite a bit of time. And then, of course, the scoring system should lend itself to some statistical treatment, and most of them do. The tendency among people using scorecards is to be too arbitrary.
They have some idea that 10 is some sort of, let's say it's a scorecard of 0 to 20, and that 12 represents some sort of real value. Well, it doesn't represent a real value. First of all, the judges have been judging things that are, they have variable interpretations of. And second, even with the best experience we have, in one case, the color may be more important than another case. In reality, the judge will have to become his own score maker as he continues to use the scorecard, whereas the amateur will always just say, well, it's worth 2 points. But the real good judge will know that in this case, the color is worth more than 2 points. And so he will adjust the other parts of the scorecard to reflect that. And, but that introduces a big hazard, because different judges may do that differently, because they have different amounts of experience. So this 12 doesn't represent some fixed sum, no matter how the judges get at it, because they may be getting at it different ways. They may not all be getting at 12 the same way. So there's a very big fuzziness in the 12 itself, is what I'm trying to say. And therefore, don't be too arbitrary in looking at that score. Don't make it more precise than it really is. It's based upon a different interpretation of a scorecard as to how you get to that 12. And even though it is highly significant that the result is different from another score, that doesn't mean that that you have defined it that precisely. In some cases, it's desirable to put some physical or chemical tests along with it so that that this will tend to correlate with the score. For example, in citrus juices, they have correlated the sugar acid ratio with the quality. And that tends to anchor the scorecard somewhat. If the sugar acid ratio is out of range, then the scores ought to be something else, again, over here. So that helps to take away some of the variability. Well, it's been used for a lot of things, butter and cheese and ice cream, as I have mentioned. We used to have contests for them here. It was considered the big thing on the campus to be the best ice cream judge on the Davis campus in 1932. Sounds like another world now, doesn't it? I don't know what they get judges for now. But anyway, we even sent teams to St. Louis and to Chicago, to the Grand National.
And,
Davis, yes, ice cream tasters. They still have some of these going on, but Davis has given those all up as not being very pedagogical. It was more competitive and more of a sport than it was to train judges. Although on picnic days, some of the best dairy judges of my time, which was supposed to be the time when dairy industry was at its height on the campus, were back for picnic day this year. A couple of them actually went in the milk industry and became very successful at it. You had a question?
Yeah, when they went away to, what did they do?
On ASUC.
Did they have a competition to see who could taste
milk? Yes, they had the expert judge for milk and another one for, it was a team went back. There were three people on the team, and they were selected by a man the name of, I'll think of his name in just a minute. And they gave a class on this, a non-credit class. We also had animal judging at that time. We sent people to the animal judging thing. And we still have some of these in high school, although they don't mean as much as they used to. There's a scorecard for milk products that takes into account the good products, things, and the bad things. And then there would be an expert judge who would set the scores for three or four or five different kinds of milk, and butter and cheese, and then the team would do this, and their scores were compared with the scores given by the expert judge. Now, there were some things that were wrong about this one here. Suppose that you were more expert than the judge. And there were some people that were more sensitive than the judges. They used to put salt in the cheeses to change them, so to see if you could catch it, so forth. And they would blend in certain amounts of lactic milk into the milk in order to make a difference in lactic acid content of the milk. Well, they were supposed to be so sensitive that they could pick these things out, you see, and put them in the right order and so forth. At any rate,
they use these scorecards. And as I say, if you were more accurate than the judges, you were penalized. You had to give reasons for your results, too, and you were graded on the reasons. And then you became the Grand National Champion Butter Taster, and so forth.
Did you guys have a few Grand National Champions?
Well, we had one, I think, butter or milk, but we were never took it as seriously here as they did other places. First of all, they had to always go east, and we only had 400 students at that time. And so it was like supplying the football team with funds as against sending a team back to St. Louis. Nowadays, with 15,000 students, that doesn't sound like very much money, but in our day it did. All right, the main disadvantages of scoring now is the tendency to drift, what we call instability, with time. Judge will start in the morning scoring, and the average, suppose he has varying kinds of orange drinks in the morning, and he will score them, average score, we'll say, a 15 out of 20. In the afternoon, he'll become more critical for reasons that we don't understand, except that we believe that he has more frame of reference in the afternoon. He's got the whole morning, 25 samples that he did in the morning to score, and so he remembers those 25 samples. He's gotten a stricter frame of reference. So in the afternoon, his average scores may be less, or vice versa. You did them one afternoon the first time, and you did them the next morning. That's to get away from any time of day effect and so forth. And the second ones will be lower in score than the first one. Well, that's what we call drifting. This can be partially gotten around by giving them an anchor with the standard. Say, this is orange juice standard that grades 12 points. So judge the rest of the samples on the basis that this one is 12. And you can even give them the amounts of scores for that 12 that came from each of these ingredients if you want. We've used this occasionally, and it does anchor them quite well. However, it's very difficult to do this with some things. It's very easy where you can have a physical or chemical standard, like the sugar-acid ratio I just said here. That's very easy. But where you don't know what the difference is due to, quality of, apple sauce, then it may be very difficult to find a standard that everybody can agree upon is 12. Now, the memory span for making quality judgments is very limited, and this is a strict disadvantage of the scorecards. You can do few of them, but gradually you do less well. It requires less time than paired comparisons or ranking, because all you're doing is putting down a score. You can do them very rapidly. It's more interesting for the judges, especially if you use some graphic method. And I'm going to show you a picture just a minute of a graphic method of scoring. It has a wide range of applications. You can develop them for almost any product. And it can be used with a number of samples, perhaps up to 15 or 20 at a time. You can also add descriptive terms to the scores. You can say, this is score number 9, and it's the best beer I ever tasted. And this is score number 1, and this is the worst beer I ever tasted. That's a one method of doing it. How do you analyze the data? Well, you can calculate the mean values. You can calculate the standard error. You can compare the samples for scores. And there are a great many other ways of doing this sort of thing. T-tests and analysis of variance and so forth. Scores are very easy to analyze. They may take some time, but they're very easy. The disadvantage is you must establish some norms for each product. And that's very difficult. It requires a lot of training. You have to allow for some shifts in liking with time, particularly with new products. And that may be difficult to do in some cases. And then you always have the product possibility, are the intervals of equal quality difference. And you also have the problem of where you use descriptive terms along with the scores, what is the judge judging on? Is he judging on the score, or is he judging on the descriptive term? Well, we find that people, when they start, this is our experience here, Ms. Pangborn and my experience, that people, when they start, use the descriptive judge, descriptive term. It's the best beer I ever had, it's the next best beer, and so forth. But after they've been at it for a little while, they then use the scores. They don't pay any attention to the descriptive terms. So the time of training of the panel will have some effect on how they're using the scorecard. Young panels, new panels, will use the descriptive terms if you give them descriptive terms for making distinction. But after they've been at it for a while, then they tend to use the scores directly. There's a contrast error built into the scorecards. That is, if you have a high quality sample, the next sample may taste worse than it really is, or vice versa, if you have a bad sample, then the sample that follows it may taste better than it really is. That's the contrast error. There's also the central tendency error. People don't want to give the top score and they don't want to give the bottom score because they feel they may be out on left field with no way of, if the score really is the other direction, they're going to be furthest wrong, so they become hesitant and they use the middle of the range more than they should. Well, I want to show you these slides of the unstructured and semi-structured and a couple of scorecards.
Okay.
Well, this is not a structured. This is not a structured or unstructured scorecard. This is a paired test, a triangle test, that's being used to find some difference. How does the different sample is given here, and then they're asked to give the degree of difference. We do not approve of this scorecard, but I'm showing you how people have used it. This is clear back in 55. If you say this one is, let's say there are 32 and 74, so the different sample is the third sample. And how much different is it in the other? And it gives you a scale, none, possible, definite, definite, and definite. Then how does this sample differ from the other two? Well, it's sweeter, or something like that. Which do you prefer? Now that's the worst possible use of a triangular taste test, but it's in the literature. And what do you do with the person who identifies the odd sample incorrectly at the very start? It introduces all kinds of complications to it. Now the next one. Here is an unstructured scale. This scale works very well. In many cases, people prefer to use this kind of scale. It just says very poor on one end, it says excellent on the other end. In some cases, there are not even any marks in here. It's just a piece of paper with a line on it. And you just put your sample on it where the line is. You'll find a very good picture in the book of an unstructured scorecard for a number of different ingredients in the same product. Unstructured with respect to color, with respect to acidity, with respect to sugar, and so forth. Just marking a mark, and then the person comes along and measures how far it is from here to here, and that becomes the average score divided by the whole thing. And the next one is a structured scale now. This is what we call a thermometer structured scale with descriptive terms. Very poor, going from 0 to 20. Fair, going from 20 to 60. Good, from 60 to 80. And very good, from 80 to 100. This, according to Mr. Professor Baker and Mr. O, is a fairly good distribution because there are more samples in this area than there are in the end areas. So in making scorecards, it's wise to have more places to land in this area than it is on the ends, so that they are not linearly separated from each other. But because most of the samples fall in this range, you should give more scores to that range. And Mr. O's 10-point scorecard does just that. This is too big a scorecard, however. It would be much better if it was divided by 10. And this was only 1 to 2, 2 to 6, 6 to 8, and 8 to 10. That would be a better scorecard. The next one? Well, this was to determine the difference for flavor or texture. And
we're going to have this next time, but I'll just show you what it is now. The first one is whether there was no detectable difference in flavor or texture.